from NQ Minerals. Pleased to welcome back David Lenigas. Hi, David.
Yeah, hi, Andrew. How are you?
Not doing too badly, David. Look, bit of news this morning on your Barnes Hill nickel project. Just update us. What work's been happening here?
Well, we've been carrying on with our pre-feasibility study work on Barnes Hill for a while. And even though COVID-19 seems to stop many companies in their tracks, you know, we're fairly lucky in Tasmania that, you know, the mining and exploration industry is seen as a critical industry for an essential industry for the Tasmanian government. So work's continuing on there. But we've just had our independent resources upgraded by Snowden's, the independent consultants who look at our JORC reporting. And we've upgraded the resource to a usable tonnage now from 14 million tonnes to about 25 million tonnes, pretty much at the same sort of grade. Yeah, if I look at Barnes Hill as a project, we're looking potentially at about 650,000 tonnes per annum throughput, about 5,000 to 6,000 tonnes of nickel metal production, 200 tonnes of cobalt. But importantly, Barnes Hill is important for Helia, our flagship operation, because the pyrites that are generated as a concentrate from Helia are very, very rich in gold and silver. So by using the pyrites to create sulfuric acid, which is one of the key inputs into a lateritic nickel project, we also can potentially recover circa 25,000 ounces of gold a year and about 500,000 ounces of silver a year on top of the copper, lead and the zinc that we'll also recover as part of this process. So it's a very integral part to the Helia's next phase of life, apart from just running through the current sort of, you know, 10 million tonnes of reserves that currently exist at Helia.
You mentioned in the announcement there'll likely be no need here for a tailings dam at the mine. Just tell us a bit more about this.
Yeah, look, the whole concept is that the hole we dig to create the ore feed for the processing plant actually creates the opportunity to put the waste material back into the pit. So, yeah, it's quite a novel idea that the guys are working on. And, you know, it's used in some places around the world. But the whole idea about, you know, Barnes Hill is its enviro credentials. You know, it's really being pushed by NQ about, you know, being part of the suite of EV metals that, you know, the world's going to need more and more of. You know, nickel, cobalt is definitely a big part of it. You know, lead, zinc, gold, silver, it's all part of the new generation metals.
And as far as access and infrastructure, you're in a good spot there, aren't you? Close to the Bell Bay port?
Well, Bell Bay is one of the big deep water ports. I mean, they bring Cape-sized ships in there. Some of the biggest, you know, mining companies in the world have huge, you know, smelter facilities and everything at Bell Bay. And Bell Bay is very close. So, you know, 250,000-tonne ships come into Bell Bay. And one of the interesting things about Bell Bay is that once Barnes Hill nickel project gets going, we can supplement higher grade feed from anywhere in the world, and we can bring it in bulk in, you know, very large ships and take it to the Barnes Hill operations for processing. So to have access to cheap power, big ports, good infrastructure is key. And the other comment about infrastructure, Andrew, is, you know, Barnes Hill is right next to the Beaconsfield Gold Project, which we've acquired or in the process of finalising the acquisition. And it literally is the project right next door. So to buy Beaconsfield actually buys a lot of infrastructure that can actually be dual used between Barnes Hill and Beaconsfield. So the two are co-pathetic, which is fantastic.
So what is the big focus here as far as Barnes Hill? You're going to kick off some of the engineering work now, are you?
Look, the engineering design work's been going for quite a while. It's about getting all of the inputs ready for the PFS. You know, the original plan was to have the PFS finished within the next few months, and I think we're pretty much on track for that. So we needed to come up with the new, you know, JORC resource, because it's that resource that turns into a reserve. And, you know, that's part of the reason for the announcement today. And there's quite a few, you know, institutional groups looking at NQ Minerals, not just for the Helia operations and what we're doing at Beaconsfield on the gold front, but, you know, there are some particularly looking at us with respect to our nickel cobalt strategy.
What about on the offtake front?
There's no shortages of offtaker for copper and for cobalt and nickel and gold and silver. You just sell to the mint. So offtakes, you know, is not a concern for a project like this. You know, there's a line coming around the street for people who want to buy a new oncoming nickel supply.
So in Q, David, you reckon in quite a nice position in Tasmania at the moment?
Well, you know, Tasmania's our focus, and you know, we're good operators there. We're a big employer of in the community. It's northern Tasmania, so we can share a lot of our existing infrastructure. You know, we like working in Tasmania. We see that there's huge opportunity for growth, not only in these projects that we've already got within the portfolio, but other ones that we continually look at and review. So, you know, Tasmania is the focus for us, yeah.
And I suppose since you and I last spoke, you've been keeping in regular contact with the team down there. How are they coping? How are they getting on?
Fine. Yeah. Look, you get little hotspots all over Australia, but Australia's COVID-19 scenario, if you look at the curves, I mean, yesterday they had, you know, 20 new cases of COVID-19. I mean, I was speaking to some of our management in Queensland who look after the Tasmanian operations. I mean, they're saying for 2 days in a row, they've had no new cases in Queensland at all. So, you know, the curve in Australia is showing, you know, world-leading stands. And, you know, they can do that because, you know, they're an island. And, you know, when they shut the island down, it sort of gave them a far more manageable scenario. And Tasmania itself is an island within an island nation. So they shut down, they shut down before the rest of Australia. So there's a very big push to get Australia back to work and back moving. But, you know, I was speaking to one of our senior management there a few days ago, and 80% of the Australian workforce is still at work, which is very different compared to the rest of the world. So, yeah, fingers crossed Australia comes out of this, you know, the COVID-19 pandemic a lot quicker than anybody else. But, you know, we're also seeing some very, very interesting scenarios, what's happening in the global base metals prices. You know, with the COVID-19 pandemic starting to spread into key mining areas like South America, North America, Europe, you're seeing copper and base metals production dropping off because mines are either being shut down or going into care and maintenance. So we're seeing a gradual increase in what's been a pretty bad year in 2019 for things like lead and zinc prices, which helps us. And of course, you know, the gold price, you know, and the silver price continue to perform very well. And there's a big, big, big push for us now to get out the new JORC resources for Beaconsfield on the gold front and get that project up and running. You know, the consultants and all the team have been working on a plan that if possible, we would like Beaconsfield to be in gold production by the end of this year. So there's a lot going on for the team.
It's interesting, just on that point you raised there, with all, particularly in Europe, with the lockdowns and less cars on the road, people have noticed the reduction in air pollution. So no doubt, I would imagine this is going to escalate the push towards EVs and production there too.
Well, I mean, if you look at the oil price dropping to, you know, WTI dropping to minus the other day, I mean, you'd sort of think, well, this is the sort of the era of the American traveller coming back and buying petrol at, you know, 20 cents a gallon. You know, whether it's short-term or long-term lived, I don't know, but I think that the world is now pretty much focused that if we look after it a bit better, you're going to end up with a lot more blue sky days. So I see the, you know, even though the oil price has collapsed, you know, these things are generally temporary, and you know, around a third of the world's oil consumption goes into aviation, and you know, aviation will recover. Everything always recovers. So, but I think the world's already on a green agenda anyway, and yeah, it's something that can't be changed. But it just goes to show, you know, if you look after the planet a bit more, the planet looks after you. I mean, there are places in India that, you know, can see the Himalayas for 150 kilometres away that could, you know, probably hasn't seen the Himalayas for nearly, you know, 60, 70 years. I think it's a good message to the young kids and some of the, you know, some of the people who inhabit the world today.
Indeed. David, nice to chat. Thank you.
Yeah, no, pleasure. Thanks, Andrew.